I made it. So thank you guys for being here. We are going to start with a baby dedication, but it's going to be an imaginary baby dedication because the baby's not here. So I'm just saying. Tank and Bailey have come all the way here for us as their church family to be able to dedicate their baby. They're at the store getting coffee. So when they come in, I want you to erupt in applause as they walk in. Not them. So while we're waiting from down here on the floor, I hope you can see me, Jack. I'll go ahead and allow them to do the announcements, and then right after the announcements, I'm sure our baby will be here by then. If not, Alina has offered to step in with Cordelia, and we're going to put a blue headband on Cordelia, and it's going to be a stand-in. So, all right. What you got, Chris? Thank you guys very much for being here. Oh, do we have any birthdays today? Hey there, young lady. How are you? High five. Booyah. This is Tori, or Ariel. Oh, that's right. Yes. What candy bar are you going to get for me? Okay. You going to make her stand on? Yes. So, just extra announcement. Jody has been with this church since well before it was ever a church. She has been one of the first friends we ever had in West Virginia. We've been together for a long time. So she is, I could call you the matriarch, pretty much, of the church. You've been here since day one. All of our pictures when we moved in and we were painting the walls have Jody in them. Okay, I think she's the only one. I know it really hurt you guys to sing beautifully last week, and you actually did it, and I didn't know you had it in you. So now you can come unglued all you want. Is it his birthday too? What do you get for being late? Wait. Okay, everybody get ready. Don't move, Jody. 3, 2, 1. Woo! I hope your coffee was worth it. We already had the baby dedication. You missed it. Tank, you got to stand up on your own first. Birthday, my brother. Come on. It's your punishment for being late. Jody, come on. Here we go. 1, 2. We don't have our opera singers. You got to get crazy. Come on, Carrie. Be part of the group. Don't be an old maid. Sing extra loud to Carrie. She won't stand up. 3, 2, 1, go. Happy birthday, Jody. Happy birthday, Tank. We had a little punk rocker up there. She was doing the... Okay. Thank you, guys. Happy birthday. I want to remind you before we hit the other announcements. Stephanie Kitchen. All right. Bring it in. Stephanie Kitchen is at home on her back watching us on a TV over top of her foot in the air. And she's doing well. She's in a lot of pain, but she can't move. And she promised she was joining us today, so we give you a shout-out, Steph, and we're going to be praying for you. So, all right, tell me what else you got, and I'll give you the rest of mine later. Wings Bible Study this coming Saturday. Okay, bring it in so everybody can hear. 10 a.m. starts fellowship, coffee, talking about their husbands, and then 10:30, they actually start the Bible study. It is an awesome program. All right. And, oh, yes. That'll be this coming Saturday. It's at New Heights. And for those of you that have never heard Jim and Valerie, they used to be part of our praise band before they moved to Nashville. They are phenomenal. Please make plans to go if you can. We're going to hope to get a good show of Word of Life people there. We like to embarrass them. So, All right. Is that all you got? Okay. Give you update on the Gilbert gospel event that occurred last week. And you guys drove up there and back every day, 2 hours up, 2 hours back, and spent the whole day there. 655 presentations of the gospel, 52 people accepted Christ. And they had, 6 to 8 rededications. So that is phenomenal. That's why God has blessed us in supernatural ways every year before you even begin putting it together. So, bless you. And as far as, hey, buddy. The building, we have the main front deck, the whole framework done. The back wall is about done. The floors, Tommy and Mark have just about single-handedly, with just a few things that myself and Corey and Bub have done. You guys have been putting the floors in just hard and steady. So I'd say we're looking at 3 weeks. That's what we were just talking about, potentially, before we'll start rolling the furniture in. Okay, if things go well. So it's really looking good. And I thank everyone from the bottom of my heart for all that they're doing. It's been amazing to see us do as much as we have. I really did. I just didn't think we could get that much done that quick. So bless you. And the only other thing that I would like to bring up is just our prayer requests for Stephanie at home, especially right now for Emily. For Dawn. Don stays quiet, but he's always definitely in need. And for Daisy, and for Mike Spencer, and for my brother David. And we'll open in prayer with that, and then we're going to go directly into the baby dedication if you guys are ready. And yes. Move to November 21st, the new court date. Okay, big prayer going on there. And that's for Tori and what's going to happen in the future. Ariel. Okay, again, if you guys will stand with me, we're going to open in prayer. And what you do with your hearts right now, pay attention if you would to this, what you do with your hearts right now, how truly you open them up and ask the Holy Spirit to come and lead us. Depends upon how this service goes, whether we honor God, whether he helps us in our worship and our message. It's up to whether we want him here. He promises where two or three are gathered, he's in our midst. So guys, let's spend this time really wanting him to join us. Okay, let's lift him up. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now. And Lord, the blessings we have, so phenomenal. And we always focus on the negatives. There are so many people in this very congregation that have so much going on in their life that we don't know about. So Lord, we stop now. We clear our minds and our hearts. And I ask my brothers and sisters to join me. Lord, fill us with your Spirit. Take control. Let us, help us. Surrender completely to you. Let our longing be to know you more, to feel your presence, to see your face. Help us to surrender to your word. I pray that you would bring the word. You would bring the love for one another. You would help us accept the word in our hearts. Lord, I praise you for those that were saved at Gilbert. I praise you for how you've worked in miraculous ways to bring us the building. Now let us use it as a tool to love on the lost. And Lord, we lift up Stephanie. I ask you to let her feel your strength, your healing, your presence and peace right now, even as we pray. And we pray for Emily Seitz and Daisy and Don and Michael Spencer, who's such a strength in his family, Lord. We pray for Ronnie Brown, a sweet brother, bringer of the word, such a loving man who is a pillar of his family. I pray you'd lift him up and you'd give him strength, refreshing, clarity, and joy. Lord, we ask you to come now. Let us just be absorbed in your presence. You take over. We love you. We praise you. In Jesus' name, amen. All right, please be seated. If you'll turn the lights back on before we sing, I would rather open up with baby dedication. And if you two will come on down. So I know everybody knows these two, but this is what I want to say. They are so much like my children that it's going to be hard. John, you've done a good job. Alina was here 3 months ago with her husband, Michael, and precious little Cordelia. So just 3 months ago, we were able to dedicate Cordelia. And now her little cousin, big cousin, actually, comes. And it means so much when you guys will travel this far to let this be the family that dedicates this little guy. So Lieutenant Jonathan and Bailey Smith have come to dedicate. I'll give you his nickname in a minute. But I know that this kid is going to be something different. Not just because of the parents, but how many kids were born dead in the middle of the worst hurricane to ever hit the area in all of American history? He was born dead in the middle of a hurricane with heart issues that could take his life. So he had his heart going against him. He was literally in the middle of a hurricane. John and Tracy drove through floodwaters to get there. And yes, and so he came out not only through the hurricane, but strong as an ox, and then came through the surgery, which should have made him lose weight and become decrepit. And he's grown to be so big and strong that the nurses nicknamed him Chonk. So it stuck. So I think it's appropriate that a baby's named Chonk if dad was named Tank. So now, you put this with it. For those of you that don't know Bailey, she is one of the toughest, most strong. She is the match that it would take to calm Tank, because she is as competitive as he is. And one day they're going to take each other out, and they're competitive. You put all that DNA in this, and you can imagine where we're going to go in the future. So I have watched both of you two grow spiritually and physically through the years. I mean, we got pictures of you, one down here. And here's the thing. I've watched both of them. You know, you get to an age you don't want to believe because mom and dad believed, right? But those roots are there, but you need to believe because it's your faith. And I've watched both of you go through periods, and you trusted me enough to share it. When you get to that age, you begin to question on your own what you're going to embrace in life. And I've watched both of you with your whole heart embrace your faith in Jesus Christ. And so this child is going to be raised in a wonderful home. And you're reflecting that today. And I want you, we do this. This is not just ceremonial. It's a wonderful point that we stop and we recognize where we're going to go with the future. And I want you guys to very seriously listen. And I ask everybody else here to listen, because you're part of it as well. We can't choose what Chonk is going to do with his life and his faith in God. Baby dedication doesn't mean we've given him to God and he's okay. What it means is that Jonah, first time you've heard his real name, that Jonah, we're going to do everything. You're going to do everything. You're committing your life to making sure your number one priority is that he knows everything he can know and experience in Christ. That's what a dedication is. Okay, and we're all joining with him in that. When you have a child, it's a literal direct gift from God. Psalm 127:3. Behold, children are an inheritance from the Lord. The fruit of the womb is a reward. Like arrows in the hand of a warrior, so are the children of one's youth. Happy is the man who has a quiver full of them. I'm not saying anything in particular. A quiver full. Wow. But you want to read that? This commitment is really one of your single biggest callings, no matter where you go in life. And you guys have started such a wonderful life. You've done so much to secure your future here. But this commitment is more important than even that. And here's why this is important today, guys. And I hope everybody listens, and I know you guys will listen. You can't be passive in how you're going to raise him for Christ, because the world is not passive or apathetic. They are openly, purposefully, decisively trying to take your child away from God. And that's just, we know that. We're in the craziest times we've ever been in. So if you guys aren't lovingly but aggressively trying to help him fight against all that, there's no hope. That's why this is more important than it's ever been. So here's your calling, 2 Timothy 3:15. And that from childhood you have known the Holy Scriptures, which are able to make you wise for salvation through faith, which is in Christ Jesus. That's our goal here. So I'm asking everybody here, realize this. If you give him everything and you don't give him who Jesus is, you failed. And I know you won't. So let's, anybody else that's involved in this family, come on down. Let's join in and stand with them. And I thank you guys for being here. Put the cousins together. There you go. Guys, thank y'all for being here today too. It's so good to have y'all. All right, here we go. Are you ready? Parents, this one's for you first. Deuteronomy 6:5, you shall love the Lord your God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your might. And these words that I command you today, you shall be on your heart. You shall teach them diligently to your children and shall talk of them when you sit in the house, when you walk by the way, and when you lie down, and when you rise. You know what that means? It means you're going to live it. You can talk all day, but you got to live it, because he's only going to do what he sees. And you have. John 13:13, you call me teacher and Lord, and you are right, so I am. If I then, being your Lord and teacher, have washed your feet, you also ought to wash one another's feet, for I've given you an example that you also should do the same, just as I have done to you. You're to live the example for him. Grandparents. Deuteronomy 4:9. Only take care and keep your soul diligently, lest you forget the things that your eyes have seen, lest they depart from your heart all the days of your life. Make them known to your children and to your children's children. You ain't out of the woods yet. So. And to other family members, nobody in particular. Proverbs 22, train up a child in the way he should go. Even when he is old, he will not depart from it. And older, in y'all's sake, you got to the age that you questioned life for yourself. And you returned to what you knew was true. And that's what you want to instill in him. 1 Timothy 5:8, but if anyone does not provide for their relatives, especially for members of their household, they've denied the faith and they're worse than an unbeliever. If that's for material things, how much more important spiritual things? That's our job. All right, so I'm going to read this off to you to make sure that I get it right. I want you to please listen to every word. This is going to be the commitment that we ask you guys to make if you want to dedicate little Jonah to the Lord today. Since you've chosen to dedicate little Jonah to the Lord on this day, I ask now that you enter into the following commitment. Do you hereby vow to guide this child towards a personal relationship with Jesus Christ through your own actions, teachings, and convictions to Christ? Do you vow to make your home a sanctuary from temptations of the world and from Satan as he grows? Do you vow to regularly bring little Jonah into a body of believers to worship, learn, and serve our God? Do you vow to help him recognize and resist the teachings of the world, which will be many, and of the many false teachers even in our own churches? Do you vow to live your life for Christ first? Teach him to do the same. Here's the key. No matter the cost or the consequences that that decision will bring to you as a family, which are very real today. If you do, please reply with, we do.
We do.
Okay. Grandparents, family members, everyone standing before me, do you hereby vow to support this couple, vow to assist and scriptural praise and correction and instruction to Jonah as he touches your life in every way. Do you vow to encourage this couple in their efforts? Take them in, put them to bed when they've had enough. To support them in every way as they raise their child in their efforts to teach him about Jesus Christ. If you do, please say, we do. Congregation, it takes a village. We are the family of God for a reason. Do you dedicate yourselves to support and encourage this family in deeds and in prayer as they nurture their child towards spiritual maturity? If you do, give us a hearty, we do.
We do.
Amen. Okay. Let me get, thank you, my brother. You're awesome. We're going to pray. And I want you guys to understand too, all of us, we want our children to prosper. God knows exactly what this child needs in every way, in every stage of life. Welcome, pray for what God wants in his life to make him who he needs to be. All right? And we anoint you, Chonk, in the name of the Father, the Son, the Holy Spirit. And guys, not symbolic, join us in this prayer and let it be real. This is the day that we dedicate ourselves to this child knowing Christ. Okay? Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you, and Lord, I just have so many thanks for this whole family, for how you've touched, how you've blessed, how you've grown, how you've brought them through so much. Thank you for the miracles that you've shown us already through this little kid's life in such precious ways. Thank you for all you've done in the hearts of Bailey, Tank. And Lord, we lift up little Jonah to you now. First and foremost, I pray that he would know you, he would trust you, he would love you with his whole life, whatever it cost him. Let him have courage, let him have strength. If it costs him everything, let him meet you on the other side, and you're able to say, well done, my good and faithful servant. Lord, I pray that you'd help him to have the job you want. Help him to find your will. Help him to have the mate you want. Help him to make the money you want. Help him to have the health you want. Help him to have the strength and the courage and the faith to be and do and have exactly what you want so that you can use him in your life. Lord, my biggest prayer is that he not be wayward, that he not miss the path that you have for him. I pray you'd strengthen Tank. I pray you'd strengthen Bailey. I pray you'd help them to live even sacrificially every day before this child so that he can see that you are king. Yes. Lord, we give this whole family to you. I praise you that they follow you, that they love you. I pray you'd strengthen them, protect them, put your hedge of protection. Lord, we love you. We give little Jonah to you all the days of his life. We give him back to you as you've given him and protected him for them. In Jesus' precious name. And they all said, amen. All right. Thank you. I love you, buddy. Guys, thank you for coming all this way to let us be the one to be with you when you did this. Thank you. All right. If you will stand, we are going to have one song to prepare our hearts for the message for praise, and then we'll sing the rest of our songs when everything is over with. I would like to have a short moment of prayer to get our hearts ready for worship and to get my Fandangle technology ready. Okay, are you ready to worship? Let's get our hearts prepared and be expectant. Let's pray. Heavenly Father, we come to you now. Let your Holy Spirit take over. Let all hearts, all minds stop everything else. Let us give you everything. Let us come before your throne. Let us give ourselves to you. Worship you, lift you up. All focus, all praise, all glory. In Jesus' precious name. And they all said, amen. Hey, buddy.
was your foe, still your love fought for me. You have been so, so good to me. When I felt no worth, you paid it all for me. You have been so, so kind to me. Coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up, mountain you won't climb up, coming after me. There's no wall you won't kick down, lie you won't tear down, coming after me. There's no shadow you won't light up. Thank you. then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. When Christ shall come with shouts of acclamation and take me home, what joy shall fill my heart. Then shall I bow in humble adoration and there proclaim, my God, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior God, to thee. How great thou art, how great thou art. Then sings my soul, my Savior. Jesus.
Thank you, everybody that came down and prayed, and sorry for the delay, but that's what church is all about. Yes. Heavenly Father, we just ask you to come now. Thank you for your spirit already. Lift up my son, Douglas. Thank you for hearing the prayers of his brothers and sisters that have prayed for him. Pray your perfect will be done. Lord, bless the word now. You bring it. You enforce it through your spirit. You drive it home in the hearts that need it. Let us honor you, glorify you, and worship you in every word spoken in Christ's name. They all said. Children's Church is dismissed. As they're leaving, we're going to be talking about a subject, obviously, if you're a Christian, you know something about promise you everyone will hear something today that maybe you've never heard. Oftentimes need to reflect, and there's a lot of people that need to hear this for the first time. And going through this will definitely help us to see Christ in a fresh light, no matter how long you've been a Christian. For those of us that have lived in the joy and the security of being saved, we've done it for so long, we don't remember what it was like to be lost and aimless and not know why I'm here and not know what the future holds. We don't remember what that was like to be all alone. And we've been saved for many years, but oftentimes we still have missed so much of what has really happened, what it really costs. And then there's a lot of people that will hear us, maybe in this room, definitely in the sound of our voice out in the world, who don't know Christ, and they have so many questions about salvation. I mean, you know, the term has gotten so old, you put it with the rickety preacher with the crooked finger, getting saved. And we've thrown that term around until it's just become a cliche religious term. You don't even know what it means. So what does it mean to be saved? And why is what I believe so much more important than other religions? Why am I right and nobody else is right? These are very valid questions. Why isn't everybody saved in the end? We're going to look at some of these questions and a few more. And I'll try not to take too long, but there is not a single more important topic. Are you listening? Please say amen. That any one of us will ever hear about or debate in our life, ever. This conversation this morning, so I ask you to tune in. And you're going to know what it really means to accept Christ. And you're going to know unmistakably, definitively, why He's the only way. So I can say that very, very confidently. So let's jump right in. Start from literally the beginning and answering the question, why do I need to be saved? What is saved and what am I getting saved from? So we're going to start very basic and we're going to go very deep. And this is going to be like going from the kiddie pool into the deep end with the diving board real fast. But we got to start here because some people really, this is where you are and you need to know everything. All right. So this is what being saved means when explained. Let's start at the beginning of the book where God did. Genesis 1:1, then verse 26 to 28, then 31 for time. In the beginning, God created the heavens and the earth. Listen, going to verse 26. Then God said, let us make man in our image, according to our likeness. Let them have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, the cattle, over all the earth and every creeping thing that creeps on the earth. So God made man in His own image. And the image of God, He created him. Male and female, He created them. Then God blessed him, and God said to them, be fruitful and multiply. Fill the earth and subdue it. Have dominion over the fish of the sea, the birds of the air, and every living thing that moves on the earth. What's that last verse say, class? Then God saw everything that He made, and indeed it was very good. Not good. Not, that's all right. Very good. So He made a perfect, beautiful paradise, and He called it very good. He created man and woman in His image. You know what that means? That means He made us to have emotion and the potential to love and devote. That meant He made us intelligent and creative and skillful and loving and productive. And He made them perfectly designed to physically, emotionally, spiritually, psychologically be everything that the other one needed with God in the middle. And He gave them a perfect place for love and acceptance and living. And He gave them authority over everything. And He came and He walked and He lived amongst them. Perfect. Awesome. But because of an angel that had fallen and become the king of the fallen angels, Lucifer, he swayed them. Here's what Adam and Eve chose in their sin. They didn't just choose to eat a piece of fruit they weren't supposed to eat. They chose to become their own gods. Satan made them think that God was holding out on them and that there was more to life. And so they wanted to disobey God and become rulers of their own destiny and choose their own way and become like God and choosing what they wanted and forget God. Forget that I'm in His garden. Forget that He made me. Forget that He's blessed me. Forget that I've got everything I need. God's holding out on me. I believe this guy. Is that not what we believe today? Is that not why you don't want to follow Him today? Yeah, but I got to give up this and this and this. And well, He just wants so much. That's old fogey stuff. I don't want to believe that. Satan has taught us that we can't trust God either. So they turned against, they rebelled against God. They ruined everything. And God said, I can't let you go on like this. I love you, but I'm not going to let you live forever when you have evil in your heart now, because evil in your heart, when it springs up, that root will grow and grow and grow. And it only takes the right circumstances for any one of us for that evil to become overwhelming. I think all of us have seen times in our life we realize that. So God had to curse all of creation. And there was separation from Him. And that evil was taught and passed on to every generation since. And we took a perfect world and we destroyed it. And Romans 5:12 says it well. Therefore, just as through one man's sin entered the world, and death through sin, and thus death spread to all men, because all have sinned. We're not held accountable for what Adam and Eve did. We're held accountable that we've chosen our own sin as well. Romans 3:23, for how many class? All have sinned and fallen short of the glory of God. I want you to give your heart to this. I don't care if you've been a Christian for 30 years, because you're going to hear something that's going to rattle your heart. This is God's word. Okay. So salvation then, to be saved, it's God's plan. Not to just get us into heaven, but it's God's plan to take away the guilt, to take away the sentence, to take away the shame, to take away the separation between us and God. He came to renew our hearts and our souls. That's what being saved is. Get this in your head, every one of us. Being saved is not your golden ticket to heaven. Has nothing to do with it. Nothing. It's a byproduct. Being saved is saving you in your heart and soul and thoughts. It's giving yourself back to God and wanting to be what He is. That's what being saved begins with. Does that make sense, class? So don't get it wrong. Being saved ain't about going to heaven. That's just a byproduct. It's understanding who we're supposed to be. And let me tell you what Jesus came to do. Satan didn't beat Him so that He'd just have to start over with plan B. What Jesus came to do in saving us was to save us and to save everything in creation and make it all perfect as though nothing had happened. He came, let's let this explain it. Revelation 21:5. Now I saw, this is at the end, after all the redemptive work has been done. This is what we're going to see very soon, class. Okay? Now I saw a new heaven and a new earth. For the first heaven and the first earth had passed away. Why? Because they were cursed. Also, there was no more sea. Then I, John, saw the holy city, New Jerusalem, coming down out of heaven from God, prepared as a bride adorned for her husband. And I heard a loud voice from heaven saying, listen to this, this is making all things new. Behold, the tabernacle of God is with men, and He will dwell with them. They shall be His people. God Himself will be with them and be their God. God will wipe away every tear from their eyes. There should be no more death, nor sorrow, nor crying. There should be no more pain. This is not a fairy tale. This is coming that far. There should be no more pain, for the former things have passed away. Then He who sat on the throne said, most beautiful words in Scripture, class, behold, I make all things new. Do you know what it cost Jesus Christ to say those words? Do you know? He couldn't just say them. It was at a price. Your salvation is the price it took Him to say those words. And He said to me, write, for these words are true and faithful. So God knew we were going to fall even before He placed us on the earth. If He knows everything, He knew what we were going to do before He made earth, right? So that puts you in a dilemma. That kind of makes you mad. Well, if you knew, right? You hear it all the time. Ephesians 1:3. Blessed be the God and Father, this is not up there, of our Lord Jesus Christ. Listen to these words. Who has blessed us in Christ with every spiritual blessing in heavenly places, even as he chose us in him before the foundation of the world, that we should be holy and blameless before him in love. He predestined us for adoption to himself as sons through Jesus Christ, according to the purpose of his will. So what he's saying is, before we were ever put on the earth, before the first day of creation, when all was made beautiful, God already knew it was going to happen. He'd already said, Jesus, are you going to be okay with this? Here's what's going to happen. So he knew the plan. So you got to think, every day that's lived out in all of history, every page that's been written in Scripture was all planned before the foundation was laid for how he would save us when we turned on him. Every bit of it. God's in control of this. That is salvation. That's how amazing he is. He's worked every day of history to bring us back to him. Now, the next logical question for that then is, if God knew we were going to fall into sin, why did he let it happen? Have you ever thought that? Come on. I hear it from people all the time. The revelation of that says so much about God. Are you ready for these answers, class? Please say amen. Okay. He let it happen because real and intimate and passionate love require free will from everybody involved. I've tried. I kept Brenda locked in the cellar for many years. She didn't. It wasn't until I came in the money that she stayed. No. Go ahead, John. Listen, it has to be free will. You know, oh, I didn't know Brenda was up here. Oh, hey, honey. Thought you were teaching class. Yeah. God knew, listen, I hope you're listening. It'll explain so much about the character of my God. God knew that free will would allow us to reject people, would allow us to hurt people, would allow us to bring chaos and pain. Do you think he didn't see it? But he also knew, before you were even born, every soul, every hungry, broken soul that would ever be in need of saving, that would ever be born, if he did let it happen. And so he was in a dilemma. I want you to listen to this dilemma. He kind of had three options from what I can see. One was he could never create this magnificent masterpiece of mankind, that even though they would fall, he would one day see the hearts that really wanted him, redeem them, and have a perfect and eternal and beautiful relationship and adventure and excitement that would never end. He could just decide, it's not worth the pain. I'm going to just stop here. Right? It's one option. Two, he could destroy all the evil that ever existed on the earth and just start from scratch. Well, yeah, blew it, Adam. Let's start over, bring in some more dirt. Okay? And he would lose every soul. If he did that, are you listening? If he did that, if he chose that option, and how many times have you ever in your heart or said to someone else, why didn't God just start over? Why did he let all the pain go? Why didn't he just start over from day one? Because God is a fair God, and God saw the future, and God knew everyone. If God did that, guess what? Listen close. You wouldn't be here listening to me. You and I are part of the reason he didn't do that. Because he saw us before we were born, and he loved us more than he loved his own life already. And he wasn't going to stop what he knew he was going to get from some of us. So be glad that he didn't do that one, or you wouldn't be here listening. And number three, he can make a way, only him, and you'll see that, to bring justice for all the evil done. Because he has to bring justice. Because if somebody hurt one of your loved ones, you would want justice because you love them. So he's a just God. He's going to bring justice, but he still had to find a way to forgive and redeem and heal and embrace all those who saw him for who he really was. And now guess what that means? That means it's going to be hard. That's a messed up way to go. It's going to be costly. It's going to be painful. But now let me ask you something, and I ask you for a real answer because this explains everything. Is anything and everything in your life that is worthy and important not expensive? God saw all of eternity. He saw the times and the troubles we would have here like that. and he saw the eternity with us because of the times of trouble like that from here to California. And he said, love is so crazy awesome. And what I have in store for you is so awesome that if we have to go through this little temporary time of trouble to get the real people that love me, and it's going to cost us all this for this short time, it's worth so much, and one day you will see how much it's worth. It'll be so much more worthy of all the pain you're going to go through to get past this part that you'll look back and just be so happy for every bit of it, as terrible as it seems now. That's what he meant. That's how much he sees the worth in us. Romans 8:18. For I consider that the sufferings of this present time are not worthy to be compared with the glory which shall be revealed in us. When you're going through it, it's the world, it's everything, it's terrible. But once you've gotten through and you look back and you think, if I had not gone through that, I would never be here. Oh my gosh, I'll go through it 10 more times. You ever been that way? Jesus has already seen eternity. And he knows the hell that this world is going to put us through. And he says, I had to give you free will, and that's what brought this mess. But your free will give you a relationship with me that's so awesome, you'll never think about these days again. And we hurt while we're here, but that's who God is, and he's loving, and he wouldn't do it if that wasn't the plan. That's why he did it anyway. And I want you to listen to this. Yes, we've had to go through a lot. Nobody has suffered for that decision more than God's only son. Nobody. So he didn't put it on us. He walked his own walk, and then he walked in the flesh with our walk. And this is our chance. This is what you've got to understand. We know, and we're going to talk about today, all that he's done. Why don't we just buck up and accept this? This terrible time that we're living in, this is our chance to show him the price we put on him. If he thought we were more important than his creation and his own life, and then we turn around and he's not worth me missing a bill, getting sick, going home prematurely, he's not worth that. We've already shown him his worth. When all you want to do is clench your fist and get mad about what he took, why don't you take the days we live in and say, Lord, bring it on. I want to show you in this short time that I have that I'll never have again that you are everything because you've already shown it to me. Does that make sense to you? And if it does, live it. It's hard, but it's got to be real. 1 Peter 1:6, in this you greatly rejoice, though now for a little while, if need be, you have been grieved by various trials, that the genuineness of your faith, being much more precious than gold that perishes, though it be tested by fire, may be found to praise, honor, and glory at the revelation of Jesus Christ, whom having not seen, you love, though now you do not see him, yet believing you rejoice with joy inexpressible and full of glory, receiving the end of your faith, the salvation of your souls. God allowed this, even though he knew it would be hard, for this reason. 2 Peter 3:9, the Lord is not slack concerning his promise, as some count slackness, but is long-suffering towards us, not willing that any should perish, but that all should come to repentance. 1 Timothy 2:3, for this is good and acceptable in the sight of God our Savior, who desires all men be saved and come to the knowledge of the truth. When we're complaining, Jesus is saying, yeah, but there's that one, and I know them well, and they're going to love me for all eternity. We don't have them yet. Can you just put up with it a little while longer? I got one more. I know he's coming. That's God's heart. That's what he's seeing while we're suffering through this mess that we made. And that's why he thought it was worth it. Do you not think it hurts him more than anybody to see the pain that his children go through? If we didn't have this fall, we would have never gotten the opportunity to concretely see just how crazy far my God would go to save me. Because we set it up so he could prove it. Because you can talk chicken all day, right? You can talk turkey. But how about we got to see him live it? If it hadn't have happened, we'd have never been given a real choice. If it hadn't happened the way it did, we would have never seen the horrors that following our own ways and turning against Him would actually bring. We'd have just heard a legend about it. Now we've seen it. So that's why God had to do it the way He did, even though He foresaw it. And when you get the big picture, you realize it was the only way. Now, that brings us to another question that's very, very good. If God loves everyone then, and He was willing to go that far, and it cost Him that much, then why can't everybody be saved? Oh, sorry. Pastor Snotts. Have you ever asked that question? There's a lot of people that preach it. Hey, everybody will be saved in the end. If God went to all that trouble, why not? Why not save everybody? So let me ask you a question, okay? Again, how many times have you said in your own heart, why does God let all these terrible things continue to happen? Why doesn't God just take all those evil bean heads out? Why don't He just wipe them out? Why does He let them do that? He knew that guy was going to rape that girl. He knew Hitler was coming. Why did He just take out evil? You ever thought that way? Come on. Let's think it through. If He did that, we would all be gone again. Because every person in here has contributed to the fall. Every person in here thinks about yourself and yourself only. Every person in here has the capability to be the most evil person in the world. We've already got it in us. We've already proven it. Now, I want you to think about this. If we get angry, this is what's so funny. When you put it in perspective, you laugh at yourself. We get angry because God won't remove the sin around us that hurts us in this little span of time that's our life. Right? You listening? And yet we get angry when God won't take the same people we're asking Him to remove right now because they're hurtful and annoying and evil. And why should you even love them, God? We get angry and say, God, why won't You save them and put them in heaven forever? If You don't, You're not a good God. It's the same God You were asking to turn this guy into charcoal last night. The bottom line is this. He gave them free choice. He loved them enough to die for them. If they still choose rebellion against Him, they still choose to hurt His people. If He truly loves His bride and He's making all things new, do you think He's going to bring that person who has free choice back into a new kingdom so they can destroy it and hurt His children all over? And if He did, would you call Him loving? No. Against His own will, literally, over His dead body, those people stepped into hell. But He had to let them do it rather than hurt His bride after He went through so much trouble to save them. That's why everybody can't be saved, because if they were, they would be simply a computer program. But they're free will beings that chose to hurt and kill and destroy, and He can't redeem them, so He's got to get rid of them for the ones He does love. That's their choice. Matthew 25:41, then He will also say to those on the left hand, depart from Me, you cursed, into the everlasting fire prepared for who? The devil and his angels. It was never God's plan for us to have to go there. He made it for the devil and his angels, but He made plenty of room because He knew what we would do. But He didn't want to even put our name on the door, because we have a way out of it. Satan and his angels don't. I hope that answered that question very clearly, because the answers are so there if you just walk with God and listen to Him. Now, I want to tell you very quickly, because we're gonna cover the facet of it. This was the prelude up to this main. What is salvation? What does it really mean? Some of you here have truly been saved and known Jesus, and you still don't know everything you kind of got with the package. Kind of like you find that button on that car 2 years later and don't even realize the car would have done that. Exactly. Especially at my age when you get that fandangled technology and them new cars. Well, the newest you can, I mean, I bought a 2010. That's pretty new to me. But all right, so it's easier to tell you first what salvation is not, because most of us got that really messed up. And that's okay. We're living in a time that does that to us. But guess why it shouldn't be okay for long? Because if you love Him, you ought to be able to discern it on your own. Because after all, He kind of wrote a bunch of love letters to you. So listen to this. Are you listening? Say amen real loud.
Amen.
All right. Salvation is not just getting your sins forgiven. Look what you did. Look what you did. You're exactly right. But I'm trying to show the world's ways of pushing it off on other people. You're killing me. Salvation is not fussing at your pastor when he does wrong. No. No, listen. All right, let's bring it back here. Salvation is not about just getting your sins forgiven, which is what every church and every pastor and every person interested in salvation makes it about. It's not about getting to heaven. It's not about just getting paradise when you die. Sadly, that's what most of us turn it into. That's a part. It's not about living a better life, and it's not about coming to church. It's not about believing there is one God, even if you believe that it's Jesus Christ. James 2:19, you believe there's one God, you do well. Even the demons believe and tremble. What he's insinuating there is, hey, good job. You're going to hell with the devil. You're more accountable if you believe there's a God and you know that it's Jesus Christ, if you don't act on what salvation means. Okay? So that's not what it's about. Salvation is not about proclaiming your belief and trust in Christ, screaming to the world you got saved, just to go out and proclaim his name over every blessing you need, but continuing to live the way you want. That's not salvation, although the majority of the United States thinks that it is. It's, I'll name your name, I'll call your name to the world, I'll do what I want, because I'm saved now. Remember, once saved, always saved. I proclaimed your name. Get off my back. I'm going to make it. I might lose a little bit of reward, but I'll make it. You better read close. Salvation is not given. Are you listening? It's not given. This is where we mess up. It's not given because Jesus is so nice. He decided to erase those laws. He decided to just let you slip on in. He decided to bend a few rules. He decided for the good old boy. When Jesus came, listen close. He didn't do away with the law to get us in because he's so nice. Because he's just, because he's righteous, because he has to be fair, because if he wasn't, we wouldn't like him. Everything anyone has ever done must be paid for, not brushed aside, because he is just, and it's not fair to the people that got hurt if it's not punished. So you don't get a ticket to heaven because he decided to just forget about it all because he's so nice. You get a ticket to heaven because he paid for every single thing, point blank, literally, that was done. He came. Okay, we have laws on the books, right? If you break the law, you got to suffer the consequences. Somebody's got to serve that sentence. Jesus came to live it out. Realize this is salvation. Now, that's what it's not. That's what it's not. Here's what it is. And I know we got a late start today. I'm not going to take a whole hour, but we got a late start for a wonderful reason from God. And you got to hear this. Okay? Get you some coffee. This is what salvation is. Number one, I want you to walk through this with me, and I want you to ask, have you done this? Realize that you have sinned against, lived against the God who loves you, and he is the reason your butt is sitting on blue fabric right now. He is the reason you're living and thinking and staring at this bald head. He gave you life. You're sinning against that guy. That guy that happens to own the creation that you're part of. It's his. And he was nice enough to put you here. It ain't your creation. And it ain't your life. You had nothing to do with it. Realize you've sinned against him. Realize that the stuff that's in you, you've seen what you can do this much. Realize that what's in you is the egg that will hatch and ruin everything that God has ever created to be righteous and wonderful and selfless. Selfless love is who Jesus is, and we know we're not selfless. That means Not a soul in here, no matter how much better you live than someone else, not a soul in here will enter the gates of heaven. You are not allowed. I am not allowed. That just hurts us and offends us so much. But think about who you are. Think about walking into a perfect, selfless, precious, loving world. What would you do to it? God knows it. And it tears his heart out. But he says, you will not come. So realize you live in his creation. Realize he is perfectly, selflessly loving. And realize what you look like to him. And realize you ain't getting in. He should just get rid of us. And then realize. And you got to really realize. I want you to listen. In spite of it all, the unbelievable worth that this one man, a real literal entity, Jesus, you got to realize the worth and the love. He put so much worth on you that he is going to destroy every atom in the known universe to save us. And he would do it if it was only you. And that is truth. Listen, let's put this together in our heads. Don't think about anything else. Give him the thoughts you should give him right now. Realize that Jesus Christ is the eternal God. He's masterful. He's artistic. He's our creator of all that exists. This guy, think of what's going on between those ears. The one who is worshiped and loved by an innumerable amount of beings that see his preciousness and see how he loves and see how humble he is. And because he's so precious, not because he threatens them, they fall at his feet and say, we love you so much. And because of that, he's been entrusted with all riches and all power and all authority and all justice, because no one can be trusted with justice more than that precious heart that he has. And you think you know so much, and you're so smart, and you're so much better. And the one that does know all, he's so humble and precious and sweet that countless beings have just entrusted everything to him. He, are you listening? He gave all of that up, all that glory, all that recognition, all that power, all that authority. Because he, in his unbelievable love, decided none of that is as important as a love for a single soul. And look at the worth we put on each other. He gave all that up and he became one with you. He walked on this earth so there's nothing you would experience that he couldn't share with you, because he loved you that much, that selflessly. Then not only did he walk with us, but he suffered physical pain like we could never dream. He lost his reputation. He died as a criminal, a worm, naked and hated. And then he had to experience the absolute, utmost, worst possible shame and rejection. That sweet soul in his heart had to experience that moment. My God, why have you rejected me? Why have you forsaken me? He had to experience the hell, the real literal feeling of hell, that I am cast away and I will never be known or loved by anyone. I am all alone. Jesus had to experience that. The least likely person to ever have to experience that, took it on full force. Hated it. Dreaded it so much he sweat blood and tears. And you say, how could God, in those few moments of pain, how could he pay for an eternity of punishment that I was supposed to receive? Have you ever asked yourself that? Well, he suffered for a little while, but he didn't live in hell for eternity. Well, I want you to get this. My Jesus is an eternal being. Right? With the most pure and righteous heart. He suffered the most incredible torture, and then he suffered the most emotional, spiritually devastating loss that he could possibly experience. Right? How long is he going to live? He will be the only soul in heaven with an eternal memory of of living through hell. Did you let that sink into your bones? He will be the only eternal being in heaven with the vivid memories of experiencing the torture and the suffering and the rejection and the outcast of hell. And he will carry it with him for eternity on our behalf. And you won't have that memory. That's how an eternal God pays for an eternal punishment. Salvation means you see all this and you realize he deserves everything in your life. Not I have to. Not this is what being a good Christian says I should do. But in understanding the being that we just talked about and what he did, shut your mouth and decide he is just worthy. Decide, after seeing his preciousness and his humbleness and his sacrifice, listen, that you want to turn away from all of those things that he thought was so horrible that that's what it cost him to get rid of. Decide, if he was that awesome and it cost him that much, you're not going to have to force me to give it up. This is what put him on the cross. This is why he'll remember every day of eternity what it was like to be living in hell. This is what put him there. I want nothing to do with it. That's what coming to salvation and repenting means. I don't want this. It hurt my God. It means I know he's so smart, and if he's that loving and he's that crazy awesome and he says this is bad, I might not be able to understand it in my stupidity, but I'm going to trust him, and I don't want it because I ain't so smart. But he is. And I'm going to trust him enough to say, no, I won't, even though I can't make sense of it, because everything else he's done makes sense and he's quite a bit bigger than me, and after all, this is his creation. Romans 12:1. I beseech you, therefore, brethren, by the mercies of God, that you present your bodies a living sacrifice, holy, acceptable to God, which is your reasonable service. Understatement of the scriptures. And do not be conformed to this world, but be transformed by the renewing of your mind, because you trust him more than you trust you. If we'll just realize that we're pretty stupid, and we think we know all that, but he really is awesome, and just come to him and say, I'm trusting you, it'll change everything. Renewing your mind that you may prove what is good and acceptable and perfect will of God. Salvation is accepting such an amazing gift given to you and knowing there is nothing you could have done about it. No amount of good works. And that God simply couldn't put it away and give you a pass. Colossians 1:13. He has delivered us from the power of darkness and conveyed to us into the kingdom of the Son of his love, in whom we have redemption through his blood, the forgiveness of sins. What if I cut open my wrist right now and you watch my blood pour out into a cup until I drop dead and I said, this is how much I love you and it's the only way to save you. What would you think of me for doing that? Now think of the most powerful, loving, effective, worshiped being in all the universe. And he did that for us. It's a reality. Ephesians 2:8. I want you to really just listen to these verses as though you've never heard them before. Now, reflecting on what we know about salvation. Ephesians 2:8, for by grace you have been saved through faith, and that not of yourselves. It is the gift of God, not of works, lest anyone should boast. Ain't nothing you can do. That's what he's saying. For we are his workmanship, created in Christ Jesus for good works, which God prepared beforehand for those who should walk in them. 1 Peter 2:24, who himself bore our sins in his own body on the tree, that we, having died to sin, might live for righteousness, by whose stripes you were healed. For you were like sheep going astray, but now have returned to the shepherd and overseer of your soul. And the last one, John 3:16. For God loved you so much that he gave his only begotten Son, whom he lived with and loved for eternity, that whoever believes in him, and that word believes means believes in who he is and what he's done, whoever believes in him should not perish but have everlasting life. For God did not send his Son into the world to, what class? Condemn the world. But that the world through him might be saved. Salvation is saying, and I don't care if you've been a Christian for 70 years, listen. Salvation is saying, if he gave his life for mine, I will give my life for his. Because that's the way a real love relationship goes. And I will live my life trusting him enough to stay away from everything he died to protect me from. And I am willing to give up anything he may ask me in his wisdom to give up, because I know that he already did it for me. And anything less, and you don't deserve his gift. It's knowing that he alone made the way and I don't need my ticket punched, because he wants somebody that wants him back. Matthew 22:37. Jesus said, you shall love the Lord God with all your heart, with all your soul, with all your mind. This is the first and greatest commandment. The second is like it. You shall love your neighbor as yourself. And on these two commandments hang all the law and the prophets. Now listen to this. Buddy, I'm telling you, every time you think you're at the end of salvation, there's just one more thing that's just... I want to drain it. Salvation is trusting that he knows you're weak. It's trusting that he knows that you've decided to serve him, but you're a mess. Salvation is trusting that tomorrow when you get up and you screw up again after you promised him. Salvation is knowing he is so awesome that if my heart is truly given to him, I can completely rest knowing he is not going anywhere, and he will help me dust off my clothes, and he will continue walking. And I don't have to stop. Here's what he wants. He wants a new heart given. He wants you're going to fall. You're going to mess up over and over and over. He wants a new heart. One that won't quit trying. When Mark and I did the liver thing, Mark's liver was dead. He wasn't going to live long, right? He got a new liver. And that new liver, although it gave him bad DNA and turned him slowly bald, that new liver gave him new life. He was a different person. Jesus does not want to forgive your legal sins. He wants to give you a heart transplant because yours is dead. His whole purpose was to change you into someone he could love and have fellowship with. Are you getting it? Forget your stinking sins. He wants to give you a transplant so that you become someone that loves him the way he wants to be loved, the way he made you to be. That is salvation. But we're willing to give him anything but that, because that costs too much. And that means, and I don't care what you think of it, this is what Jesus said. If my heart changes and he is my everything and nothing else matters to me anymore, if he comes to me and says, I want your health, I want your money, I want your relationships, I want your material goods, I want your reputation, I want you to stop this, I want you to start that, I want you to go here, you say, gladly, Lord, bring it on. Because that's what Jesus did. And if there's anything in there that just offended you, then you need to walk out because you still aren't sold for him. Because if you can't understand that someone that loves you that much and gave that much selflessly and to this day has memories of hell because he wanted to save you, and you can't give him anything he asked for in trust that he would never abuse you in doing so, what else is it going to take? Philippians 3:7. But what things were gained to me that I have counted loss for Christ. And this guy was the Pharisee of Pharisees, had it all. Yet indeed, I also count all things loss for the excellence of the knowledge of Christ Jesus my Lord, for whom I've suffered the loss of all things. I count them as rubbish, that I may gain Christ. It's gladly given in my whole life. And anything less, stop, we're almost done. Anything less, you listen, say amen.
Amen.
And you're using him. Did you hear me? Anything less than all you've got, and you're using him. You want his name to get what you want. So here's the question. Why am I so adamant it's Jesus? Why can't all roads lead to heaven? And this is quick and easy, okay? But you need to know. Because you probably ask that yourself, and a lot of people ask, well, people mean well. Why can't they just get to heaven any old way? Well, no matter how many ideas, I hope you just hang on, because we really haven't been here this long. We just started late. All right. I hope you hang on to this. If I want you to come to my house after church, but I don't tell you how to get there. Most of you wouldn't try it anyway. It's a rough road. Then you go around and you ask 10 different people and they all give you a different answer. How many ways will get you to my house? Only one. I don't care how convinced they are, how good it sounds, how joyful the ride will be, what you get to see along the way. If it's not the way to my house, you ain't gonna get there. So the bottom line is this. I don't care what anybody thinks or decides or imagines or writes about what's in the afterlife. Guess how many things are true about what's on the other side? One. That is just absolute mathematical correctness. There's only one thing that's on the other side that's really true. So, here's why Jesus is the way. Gosh, I could give you all the reasons in the world we have materially, historically, all these different ways. But this is theologically. I want you to listen. Please keep your thinking caps on. Okay? Every other religion in the world teaches you how to live more kindly. That's wonderful. Teaches you that the good must outweigh the bad. And that's wonderful. But it's just enough goodness to dissolve away everything that Jesus did. Because Jesus says, if I'm taking you to a perfect place and I need a perfect heart to love me perfectly and you're falling apart and you think you can just be a little nicer and get in and have a little more good than bad, but I never get rid of all of your sins and they're never really paid for, am I a just God? Just because you acted a little better than someone else, am I a just God? No. He doesn't want your abject humiliation and worship. He doesn't want you to act a little better. He needs to take away the sins through justice. And he needs to change the heart. I don't want you to be a little nicer. I want you to love like me. I want to transform you. Every other religion brings you a little closer by saying you need to be a little nicer. You need to do a little better. You need to let your good outweigh your bad. And it destroys the truth. And the truth is we are unjust and we need to be made just. And only Jesus offers that. Imagine being in a plane. And you're in a plane and it's going down. And there's this one guy and he's got a parachute. But there's another guy beside him that says this. Hey, don't worry. You'll be fine. Jump. You can fly. That's every other religion in the world. Don't worry. You can do better. It's in you. You can do better. While we continue to have mass extinction of each other and killing and murder and hate, and it's grown nothing but worse through all the years, all the religions of the world say, you can fly. You can do better. Now listen. But that one guy says, you did. But here, take my parachute. I'll go down. Now you can fly. And when the plane hits the ground without you, there's only, I don't care if you were rich, if you were poor, if you were pretty, if you were ugly, if you were bald, if you had hair, you'll be classified as two things, dead or alive. Right? When we get to the end of the plane ride, people, I could care less about anything else in your life. You'll be dead or you'll be alive. And the only way you'll be alive is if you took a parachute, because that's the only way you're going to fly. But every other religion in the world says, jump out and flap your arms. Every other religion in the world expects you to work your way, and it's all on you, and you better. Jesus says, you can't, but I love you so much, I will. That's why Jesus is different. No other religion does that. Of course, there's only one creator. It's the only logical assumption. No other religion has a real history of a real man that we know lived and died and rose again. No other religion has a man that had hundreds of prophecies about every detail of his life that came true in history that you can prove today. No other religion in the world. No other religion in the world has a man that has total God, dedication, love, and humility and sacrifice that he would give himself for us rather than saying, you better try harder or I will burn you. Only Jesus. That's why it's my Jesus. Acts 4:10. Let it be known to you all. He's busting some heads here. I'll give you a preview. Let it be known to you all, to all the people of Israel, that by the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I want to make sure you know the right one, that guy, that Nazarene that you hated. By his name, whom you crucified, whom God raised from the dead, by him this man stands before you whole. Someone had been healed. This is the stone which was rejected, talking about Jesus, by you builders. You build your own little empires with your religions. You've missed the cornerstone. For there is no other name under heaven given among men by which you must be saved. There's only one address home. It's logical. And this guy says, hey, pick the most unorthodox, different person in the whole world that gave himself for you instead of demanding that you give it all and you try to do it on your own. That's the real God. And that's the only name that can save you because everything else is just a Band-Aid. So, here's the last question. And I think this is going to be a big one for you, so I had to put it out there. I had to tack it on to the end. Are you ready? What about those who decide to accept Jesus in the end? Maybe even on their deathbed. They live their whole life like a hellion, and here they might die tomorrow, and they come accepting Jesus Christ. And some people say that person's going to burn in hell. And some people say, oh, it's just fine, whenever, however. Many people ask this question. As a matter of fact, I've had a couple of people asked me this question in the past week. Do you know there's a very, very solid scriptural answer? I'm going to give you a couple of verses. And it's not what you think, probably. Because the question is, can you accept Jesus on your deathbed and go to heaven? Yes and no. True and false. And this is why. If you listen, say amen. Thank you. God is not a legalist that is held to a signed contract that you can say or do a certain thing and make him jump through hoops like a little doggy. He's the creator of the universe. God does not care about any legalistic thing in your life and you did the right thing at the right time. He cares about what, class? Okay, so let's listen to this. Luke 23:39. I'm on the last page, by the way, so I can't make up it so much more. So just hang with me. Jesus hanging on the cross, two people dying with him. Then one of the criminals who were hanged, how many hours does he have left? Less than one. They're getting ready to break his legs. Okay. Then one of the criminals who were hanged blasphemed him, Jesus, saying, if you are the Christ, save yourself and us. And the other answering rebuked him, saying, do you not even fear God, seeing you are under the same condemnation? Dude, you're going to die. Are you not scared now? And I have visited people on their deathbed that were this close. And they cussed me and threw me out. So, and I know they knew God was real. And this is the guy continuing to talk. And we indeed, justly, we're going to die because we're supposed to, dude. For we received the due reward of our deeds. But this man has done nothing wrong. Then he said to Jesus, Lord, remember me when you come into your kingdom. And Jesus said to him, assuredly, I say to you, today, you will be with me in paradise. Did this man have a chance to live a single day of his life for Jesus? Nope. Was this man in his final moments on earth? Yeah. Was he saved? If you say no right now, you're calling Jesus a liar, and I'm going to pray with you. Okay. So, why? Because salvation has nothing to do with anything but your heart. Right? So now I'll give you these verses, and then we'll close. Here's the flip side of the coin. 1 Samuel 16:7, for the Lord does not see as man sees. For man looks at the outward appearance, but the Lord looks at the heart. 1 Chronicles 28:9, as for you, my son Solomon, listen close to this one, know the God of your father and serve him with a loyal heart and with a willing mind. For the Lord searches all the hearts and understands all the intents of the thoughts. If you seek him, he will be found by you. But if you forsake him, he will cast you out forever. Now, here's the final one, and I want you to pay attention to every word, please. Drink this in, okay? John 2:23. Now, when he was in Jerusalem at the Passover feast, talking about Jesus, a lot of people flocking around him, and they really did believe in who he was, okay? Many believed in his name when they saw the signs that he was doing. Listen to these words. But Jesus, on his part, did not entrust himself to them. So they came to him. They wanted him. But he said no. So that's possible. Why? Because he knew all the people and needed no one to bear witness about man, for he himself knew what was in man. So what that's saying is, a sincere heart, this is your answer, a sincere heart that wants Jesus, that came to him with 5 minutes left in their life, but they sincerely want to know him. Does Jesus see their heart? There is no legal obligation. All he wanted was your heart. And if he sees your heart, it's done. Even if you couldn't utter the words. Are you with me? But you could pray the most beautiful King James prayer in the world because you planned, and I've had people tell me this point blank, I'm going to live the way I want. I got some more things I want to do. Yeah, I know Jesus is real. I know he's a good guy. I got plenty of time. I'll accept him one day. And I had a guy tell me, and I've told my people this before. He said, when I get older and I've done a few things, I'm going to come to Jesus and then I'm going to accept him then. And he's got to accept me because his word says he will. That's like walking up to Jesus with a lawyer and saying, yo, dude, you better listen to him. You signed a contract. You know what Jesus is going to say to that. So you could come to Jesus and pray with all your heart in your last moments. And if it was just so you could put the shaft to everybody in heaven and you could spit on Jesus, and then when it came time for you to save your soul, you wanted to come to Jesus, Jesus is going to know that. And he's going to do just what that verse right there says. I see you coming to me, and on my part, I will not receive it because you won't make me jump through hoops. You won't make me play games. I am not accountable to any contract. I came because I want you to be my beloved bride. And if you just want to play legalistic games, we ain't getting married. So you can be saved with 30 seconds left in your life, living like Hitler. Or you can play games with Jesus and try to use him, and you ain't going to get there. So don't think you're going to live your life and do your thing and then come to him another day if you know who he is now, but you don't want him. Does that make sense? Simply because all he wants is your heart. Guys, he deserves everything. What else is more important? Last thing to go on the screen. Let's read it together. 2 Corinthians 6:1. Working together with him, Jesus, we also appeal to you. Don't receive God's grace in vain. For he says, I heard you in an acceptable time, and I helped you in the day of salvation. So he ends with these words, look. He probably said it like this, look, now is the acceptable time. And now is the day of salvation. So I want us to end, and I'm going to tell you this, I never have tried to give altar calls. But I do know, especially out there in that world, and I promise you there's probably someone here that you've potentially come to a point that you know God's real. And I always say, hey, if you want to come talk to me, come talk to me. And I always feel resentful when a message is this powerfully showing who Jesus is. So I ask you to stand. And I ain't asking anybody to come down. Please stand. Here's what I am asking you. I'm asking you right now, right now. Now is the acceptable time. If you've never accepted Christ, and it's not magical incantation. If you've never decided that you want to give Him everything because you finally realize what He's done for you and how crazy awesome He is, or anybody out there, then I ask you, join with me in prayer now. And right here, right now, you can literally give your life to Him and it changes everything. And if anybody stays, has been here very long, you know I don't do this because I don't, listen, I don't cheapen God's gift. But I feel strongly led that anybody that would like to pray, pray with me. Pray along the lines that I pray, but in your own heart and your own mind, you give yourself to Christ because He deserves it. And the things He has in store for you are innumerable and precious and awesome. He's worth it. Anybody out there, please let me know if you accept Him. He says, accept me with all your heart and confess me to men. Drop me an email, whatever. But just for Him, let's pray. Heavenly Father, I pray, I know there are people out there that know they need Jesus and they want Him and they just have never come to that point. And I pray now is the point. I pray your Holy Spirit works anywhere and everywhere that hears our voice and they see the preciousness of Jesus Christ and the cost, and that they would pray this prayer with me right now, Lord, in their own way, and that they would come to Jesus Christ. Anybody that's ready and willing, just pray with me. My Heavenly Father, I know You're my Creator. I know I have turned against You. I know I don't deserve You. I know You loved me enough to die in my place. I turn from everything that's hurt You. I ask You to save me with Your Son's blood, Jesus Christ. I ask You to fill me with Your Spirit. I ask You to give me strength to live for You with a new life all my days. I praise You for what You've done. And I know I am Yours, and You are mine, and You will soon come for Your bride. Jesus, I truly pray people came to know You. I love You, and I love You for Your gift, Your preciousness. Let us see it, even though saved 30 years, let us see it fresh today. We love You. We lift Your name. We worship You. Amen.
The splendor of a king. our God.